owner of the AWF, Cost Superstar, 11-time Tag Team Champion of the World. This egotistical bastard is ready to shoot the shit as Shawn Walsh presents The Shawn Walsh Show, where there is no holds barred.
All right, everybody, welcome to the world premiere of my new podcast, The Shawn Walsh Show. I'd like to welcome you guys. I'd like to thank you all for listening to my first episode of hopefully a podcast that is going to be many, 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 many months and possibly years to come. We'll see how the road is down the line. But again, I'd like to thank you for listening to this podcast. You will not be disappointed. Especially today, because we have one hell of a guest. We have Lester Barkley, but we're going to get to Lester in a little bit. I wanted to get into this whole podcast business. Since I'm now in the podcast business, I'm going out there trying to get a bunch of people in call on my show, trying to get the inside information, trying to get people to speak their minds and just have a little fun, entertain the viewers. The whole point of this, you know, a couple months ago, I got the idea of possibly doing a podcast because I've been a very big podcast fan for pro wrestling podcasts, and I really like the format of like Steve Austin's podcast, like Chris Jericho's podcast, like the Solid Monster Sounds Off, various other, the Ross Report. I'm a very big fan of wrestling podcasts, and I felt like I had a good grasp on how they do their podcast, and I can bring it into the call world, which is exactly what I'm going to do. I, however, waited a few months to do this because back when I wanted to do it, it was right around the same time when Austin, otherwise in COH known as Brandon Ross, tried to start his own podcast, which he put out an episode with Steve, otherwise known as M-Accuracy, Patriot, among various other names. And I figured, well, I guess he's got the podcast shtick now. Good luck to him. Best of luck. And as time went on, I was waiting and waiting and waiting and nothing. And, hey, you know what? People got things going on. Things happen. Didn't work out for him. It's a shame. Had a good interview with Steve, but you know, there's one thing about some of the podcasts or interview shows that I've seen here and call, no offense to the guys that have hosted them, but there's something very wrong with them. They lack a lot, whether it be Austin's show, whether it be back when David Benz did his show. There was always something missing to it, and I thought that I should bring what was missing, the missing element, to the podcast world here in call wrestling, and that's exactly what I plan to do. You know, I'm not going to just be here and just do interview and ask, oh, how did you get into call wrestling? If I don't want to know how the hell you got into call wrestling, I'm going to send you a question on Ask FM. I'm here, I'm going to get down to the information, I'm going to get the truth, I'm going to get all the stories, and I'm going to get your opinions. You know, there's no limits on the questions that I can ask or that you can ask. You're on my podcast, there's no holds barred. You can be asked anything, you can say anything. I don't care who it offends, I don't give a rat's ass who doesn't like it, it doesn't matter. This podcast is meant to create controversy. I'm going to say that to you right now, episode 1. This is to create controversy. And also to let people speak their minds. And if some people can't take criticism, well, that's too damn bad. But that's with anything. Those are my rules of my podcast, and you're gonna see how that plays out a little bit later on with my guests. But before we get to that, I want to talk about a few things going on in the call world. We have for COH, Ultimate Glory is about to happen. We've been in these few months during the Ultimate Glory season, and now we've just hit the go-home show of Battleground, and now it's time. It's time for Ultimate Glory 4. We're going to see Patriot and Zane LaFontaine. We're going to see Alex and M-Accuracy. We're going to see Great D and Fisk. We're going to see the Egotistical Bastards versus Rap Metal. going to see a lot of cool matches at Ultimate Glory. And, you know, I'm not going to get too much into my thoughts on the match card and what's going on for Ultimate Glory, because me and Sonny, we really dive into that, and we express our opinions on what on some of the decisions and matches and the path that COH has been on. So I'm going to save that for later. You're going to see my opinions and Sonny's opinions on that. But there's other call news, such as March 14th, 2015. It's finally happened. ECW is back. Extreme Call Wrestling, after a 5-year absence, is finally back in the call world. They just launched their comeback episode. I recommend all call fans, whether you are a fan of ECW like myself from back in the day, or if you've never even heard of ECW, so please check out ECW. It's a hell of a show. It's a great show. Hell, check their old episodes. They're still phenomenal. ECW has been one of my favorite shows for years, even in its absence. It's one of the first shows I started to watch. I watched ECW because I heard about it from the DWF, my favorite college show of all time. And now, and then I've been really sad that it's been gone for 5 years. It's always been a funny thing. For years, people would always go in the comments and ask when ECW was coming back. Years after ECW went on, as we in the call world say, the longest commercial break of all time. And it seemed like last year, people finally accepted that ECW wasn't coming back. There was no way. It's been all these years. And then all of a sudden, video comes out and ECW is back. It's back in the call world. I'm watching the first episode. I'm loving what I'm seeing. It's great to see Mick Michaels back on commentary. You can tell it's been some time for him, but he's still great. I still love him on commentary. Got tournaments to crown new champions. The ECW champion is going to be crowned at the next CPV, and also one hell of a main event. Brent Tyrant Hell in a Cell match. The rematch from the Great American Bash pay-per-view from many, many years ago, back in 2008. So, it was one hell of a show. I recommend you all go watch ECW, Extreme Call Wrestling. Also, I recommend that you all go to the Call All Stars Facebook page, facebook.com/callallstars. Go to the YouTube page, youtube.com/callallstars. It's not that hard to find. Go to the page, give it a subscribe, go to the Facebook page, and like it. Call All Stars has lots of news going on right now. We are currently in the, we currently have a Call All Stars tournament, where the winner of the tournament will move on to Call All Stars 7 to challenge the Call All Stars champion at that event. Currently, Call All-Star champion AJ Young, and I say currently because AJ has quite a few title defenses coming up. He's defending the belt of Ultimate Glory. There's rumors he may be defending it in a future episode of the AWF. He's defending it in DZW. AJ's all over the place defending that Call All-Star championship. If he can hold on to that championship to this summer, he's going to be fighting the winner of that tournament. Who's going to win? I don't know. The tournament has begun, though. The first match happened in a CCL web match, which we saw Ben Hitman go one-on-one with Chris Knight. Interesting match. Recommend you all check that out. We find out who's going to the second round. I don't want to give the spoiler to you guys yet in case you didn't see, because the episode just dropped. We're also going to see another match of the first round on the upcoming episode of ECF. We're going to see Jet Fusion and TCF's Terror going at it. Loads of stuff. Check all that out. Call All Stars 7 is going to be the biggest one of them all. And I hope you all check it out. Go to the Facebook page. Find all the information. You don't need to hear me talking about it. It's right there. Read for yourselves, damn it. Now, we're going to get to the podcast. We're going to go to my interview with Sonny. Me and him, we're gonna shoot the shit, go over some COH, go over some Lester Barkley stuff. We're gonna talk about the church. We're gonna talk about the rise of Lester Barkley. We're gonna talk about his feud with Kenyon Fenix, Money in the Bank. We're going to talk about some criticisms towards Sonny, and we're also going to talk about some concerns and displeasures with recent events in the Call of Honor world. So when we come back, we're going to be sitting down with Sonny. We're going to shoot the shit. Multimedia mania is running wild, brother, on the hottest new multimedia YouTube channel, Durga Burgers. The Durga Burgers offers the best forms of entertainment, including gameplays of WWE 2K15, NBA 2K15, Sonic, and the also entertaining Saboteur, which takes place during World War II, if you didn't know. We also have something for all your old gamers out there. We have Flashback Friday, where we go and play old school games. We also have podcasts on professional wrestling, television shows, and we didn't forget about you nerds out there. There is a comic book podcast called Different Panels. Durga Burgers is the destination for all forms of multimedia entertainment. Go to youtube.com/Durga Burgers and subscribe today. Alright, everybody, this is the moment we've all been waiting for. Now I am joined by Ryzen Call Superstar, Lester Barkley. I'm going to call him Sonny because I don't call him Lester.
My name?
I'm Sonny. You're okay with that, right, Sonny?
Yes.
And even if you weren't, I was going to call you Sonny anyway, but that's besides the point. Thank you for being here, being the first guest on my podcast, which is going to do more episodes than a previous podcast. Not to take any shots, though. But, Sonny, let's get right into it. We're going to get into some COH business, what's going on and whatnot a little bit later on. First, we're going to start it off with you as Lester Barkley in COH, and we're going to quickly go through, you know, where you came from, where you got to. You get what I mean?
Yeah.
All right, so you started off in the church. And mm-hmm. The church was an interesting stable, very Wyatt family-esque.
Yes.
Now tell me, did you enjoy the church? Did you think it sucked? Were you just happy to be there? What was your thought?
At the time, I would say, from the time when I debuted until, I would say Ultimate Glory, I was, like, having a lot of fun in there, being with Atticus, Kendrick, because, like, even though I think we should have talked more and stuff, I was really just having a lot of fun in COH General by that time, and I'd say things kind of start falling apart, I'd say, after Ultimate Glory, after the whole Masters of Horror feud, which, by the way, with how Masters of Horror were like, used after that, I think we should have won that feud. But that's just my opinion. But, you know, after that, it's when things really started to change from into the NATO feud, where it's like, you know, like, say Kendrick wasn't doing anything, and then... You know, Atticus, at the time, he was, like, losing steam. Hopefully, he's getting that back, Kenyon Fenix. And, I would say, you know, for majority of it, I liked it. So, you know, were there things that could have went better? Yeah, but overall, I'd say it was a good experience.
Good experience, indeed. One thing that many people talk about from the church is how Atticus Marks, now known as Kenyon Fenix, he was the leader of the group. However, many people point out that you broke out in the church, and you got a lot of credit, and you got a lot of steam from that, and that's great. That's led to your success today, and a lot of people appreciated your dedication, which led to your fans, your legion of fans that you have now. However, there have been some critics who have said that you took Atticus' spotlight from him, you went, whether it's intentional or just happened to be. You took the spotlight from him and put yourself out there as the leader, whereas Atticus was supposed to be the leader. And there's actually some information that I know of that apparently you sent some promos to Travis without Travis asking for promos, in which Travis would tell Atticus, or as I know, Adam, to not send in promos because you were sending in promos. Is this true?
Well, actually, I've heard that from Adam, but obviously because at the time we didn't really talk and stuff. At the same time, though, it's like, obviously that was not intentional at all. I was just being like, you know, being that one member who's like, you know, support the church, like, you know, just a follower kind of thing, you know? And, Yeah, the reason, like, you know, the reason I was really doing promos, like, obviously starting out on COD, it's like, it's always, like, a fun thing, and I always liked, you know, doing that promo stuff, because, like, that's the thing about COD, like, you want to act like real wrestling and stuff, and,
Hell yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, just doing that, and plus, in Steamwitch in general, it's like, that's the thing I really learned more later on than I did at the time, but it's like, you know, in order, you really do have to make the promos on your own, because I've heard, like, I've even heard other people say, like, you know, Travis doesn't really ask that much for promos. And, oh, trust me, right now, if there were a lot of people, like, a lot more people doing promos like rap metal and stuff, they would be going better than they are right now. So, yeah, like, it just came to be like that. It's like, it wasn't intentional, it really just, you know, happened how it happened.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, it would be great if more people did promos today, but we'll get into rap metal and among other people a little bit later on. You know, you know, we have you and Atticus. You guys were together. Then the church split, which launched the career of Lester Barkley and Kenyon Fenix. And it was obvious that there had to be a feud between the two, which it happened, and it had its moments, and it helped the both of you. However, in some ways, it hurt the both of you, and some would even say that it hurt Kenyon Fenix. What would you say about your feud with Kenyon Fenix? Was it largely positive, largely negative? Was there anything you would have done differently?
I think one thing I would have done differently is, okay, let's see, that started from, like, I think after Guerrilla Warfare to Anniversary. During that time, they should have booked, like, Kenyon, like, stronger than they did, because
I don't know, it was, like stuff, like, feud.
Yeah, like, and obviously, you know, that's, you know, obviously all booking stuff, that's all up to Travis and everything, but it's, like, you know, that's problem that I think even now, I would say he still needs some wins over, like, you know, not main event guys, more like, you know, the mid-carders, like, I say, because I remember, like, one Battleground, it was, like, okay, everyone's getting this qualifying match for the Cell thing at Anniversary, and it's like, okay, so you want Kenyon to be, like, this threat to me at, you know, our match at Anniversary, yet he's losing clean to Goonie. How does that make any sense?
Oh, yeah, I absolutely agree. Kenyon deserves wins. Adam needs to win more. Hopefully he does, but we'll see what happens. One thing I remember from your feud, which was towards the end, was actually an Anniversary. And no, I'm not talking about your match that blew off the feud. I'm talking about the triple threat match between you, Kenyon Fenix, and TJ Profit. And by some people, that was a little bit controversial for the fact that TJ won that match. But TJ did not pin you. He laid you out and then ran across the ring and pin Kenyon Fenix. Now, obviously, this is Travis's decision to have Kenyon take the fall instead of you, and in a way, it protecting you because you don't take the fall. How do you see that? Because I've seen some people who were actually quite upset that it was so clear that you in that match were protected, and Adam or Kenyon lost that match, and then lost to you in your singles match as well.
Carol. Anyway, so basically, how I see it, it's like, I can kind of see why they did the protecting, because, you know, like I said, you know, it's just off the face turn, and you want to, like, I think that was when I was really starting, you know, I was really starting to get, like, steam at the time. Oh, wait, is this thing?
Yeah, you were getting pushed, for sure, and still are, but, you know, some people. And I agree with this, actually, just throwing my opinion out there. Maybe it could have been something. I'm not saying Kenyon should have won the match. I'm just saying maybe it shouldn't have been so clear as to put the favor in you, or maybe you should have taken the fall because you were going to end up winning against Kenyon Fenix on the next night.
Yeah,
anyway.
Like the next night. And then, actually, I think another reason, too, now I think about it, it's like, because I remember the thing about me and TJ Profit and KFAB at the time was that I wanted to finally get a win against them, and then when I did get the win, that was when I started turning face, because I did the handshake right after.
Mm-hmm.
I'm thinking, what they probably, I think that was probably another reason too, is that they didn't want to follow that up with TJ getting the pin on me again, which that could be a reason, I'm not sure, but that's what I'm thinking. But as far as, like, the rest of the feud, I think, in a way, I think the anniversary night two match, it overall helped the both of us, because I remember, like, a lot of people were, like, giving us both praise at the time during that whole thing, and I think at the end, like, during time, it didn't really help Kenyon, but I think at the end it kind of did, because people were, like, really starting to praise him, like, right after that match.
Yeah, people are finally starting to give Kenyon Fenix some praise. It's taken a while, but hopefully now is this feud with Kevin. This will lead to much greater things for him. Hopefully all goes well for Kenyon Fenix. We'll see what he has upcoming for him. Perhaps it could be appearing at Call All Stars. Speaking of Call All Stars, I'd like you all to go right now to the Facebook page, facebook.com/callallstars. Give the page a like. Go read all the information and updates. There's information, there's news every week. There's news on there and news you must know. And then after you see that, I want you to go to YouTube, youtube.com/callallstars. It's that easy. And go and hit the subscribe button. You won't regret it. You can go back and look at old callallstars events. All you can go see all the great matches on there, and you can see what's coming for Call All-Star 7 as we enter this championship tournament. And as a little treat for you guys, while we're on break here with this special interview with Lester Barkley, we're going to give you guys a little demo here, show you guys the commercial for Call All-Star 7. Some legends are told, some turn to dust or to gold, but you will remember me, remember me for centuries. Just one mistake is all it will take. We'll go down in history, remember me for centuries. With Kenyon Fenix and the win, and now you're in Money in the Bank. Obviously, you have a lot going for you. You picked up a lot of momentum. Doing pretty well for yourself. You got your fans who are very heavily behind you and glad you're getting all the success you're getting and really hopeful that you'll win that Money in the Bank. However, there are some fans who don't necessarily have the same view, unfortunately, for you. And
Carol.
Well, maybe. However, some people don't think, whether it be you should win Money in the Bank, if that's what happens. Some people don't feel you should be quote-unquote pushed like you are. And I was – and this is a fan-submitted question.
Mm-hmm.
In which is – do you feel you deserve everything you've gotten in COH up to this point, whether it be all the wins you've gotten, all the feuds you've won, and where you're at now in the Money in the Bank? Do you feel you deserve that?
Well, really, I think in a way I kind of do, because it's like, you know, you think about it, like you said, I have been getting steam and stuff. You know, all this momentum and everything, because if people are like, you know, if people are behind a guy, obviously they want the guy to be pushed, which that's always one thing, because think about it, if Patriot never got guys behind him, he would not be world champion today. You know, so obviously, you know, if basically, like, you know, one thing about a push is obviously, you know, if you're over, you deserve a push. That's one thing. But also, another thing too, I also do, like, you know, Saka, would you consider that I do, like, a lot for COH?
I would say you do put in work for COH. There's no doubt in that. There's evidence. There's proof of that. You do that.
Yeah, I mean, you know, like, obviously, you know, promos as a wrestler and then commentary and then really any, like, extra stuff along the way. And it's also another thing, too, it's like, because obviously, you know, with along with talent, you need dedication. You can't have one. Basically, you know, you need both. You cannot have one without the other.
Oh, yeah, no, I definitely agree with you. The dedication is great, and it's a big reason why people are behind you, and it shows in that you deserve to get credit for what you put in. However, the argument that can be made against that is that, you know, and this is I'm not saying in any way that you're bad, but however, you're not the best guy, say in promos, and I'm not saying I'm the best guy. I'm not.
But well, which is very hard, because like the main event guys, I mean, you know, it's like Steven stuff. He can't, you know, it's very hard.
Yeah, but not even like looking at the main event guys. Obviously, yes, you agree that you deserve your spot and whatnot, and that's great. And now, so a question would be, do you feel you deserve this spot more than, say, a guy like a Kenyon Fenix, like a AJ Young, like a Ultimate Nitro, guys who they're putting in work, maybe is not as much as you with commentary and stuff like that. However, they're still putting in work, and on top of that, yeah, they're very skilled in their promo work, and sometimes don't get recognized.
Well, that is true, and although I will say, as far as me and, like, the talent-wise goes, I would say I improved a lot. I mean, like, even ask Travis on that, like, from my debut promo, and you compare that to now, I have, like, improved leaps and bounds. Oh God.
You have improved leaps and bounds. That, there's no doubt in that. But do you believe that you deserve it more than them? And I'm not saying that you do or don't. I'm just asking for your opinion. Do you feel you deserve it more?
Well, really, you know, it's really hard to answer this kind of question because, like you said, the really good guys, too, and it's like, to say you deserve it more and stuff, it's always like, kind of hard to say, but it's like, in this case, it's really more about, like, the build-up of your character, I would say. Because, like you said, the problem I would have for, like, pushing Kenyon into the main event right now is because the way he's booked, where he should be looking stronger and stuff, like, you know, if you book him, like, way more strong and stuff, he would deserve to be in the main event. But if, like, say, in the terms of build-up, you compare me and him, you know, who's looking a lot stronger? Obviously it would be me.
Right.
And then, like say for Nitro, for example, well, you can't really push him in the main event right now because it's like, well, you know, he's still the internet title for one, but I think, you know, because of how Slam is, where, you know, I felt that show, honestly, as a development show, it really needed more direction and more, like, feud stuff. Or I think Nitro was even lacking, like, build up before getting the internet title. So it's like, and AJ, I think AJ would be doing pretty good for himself. I mean, he's having this good, you know, feud with Caleb Blair and stuff. And I'm hoping at least it's like a good win over Caleb, because I feel both of them deserve like one win over the other. And, you know, after that feud is done, I say you could definitely have him go for, like, if he goes to Slam, maybe the global title, or at least challenge the world title.
I definitely agree with that. Now, you started to go into how certain people have been booked, like Kenyon Fenix. So let's talk more into that. Not necessarily about Kenyon Fenix, but how things are being booked in COH now, since we talked about the past. Let's talk about what's going on in COH. As you know, me and you both have some opinions on what's going on. So let's address those. Like, for example, the current state of the booking in COH. Love it, hate it. What's wrong? What's going on here?
You know, it's like, you know, Travis, he's, you know, obviously he's done a lot for me, and, you know, I've also done a lot for COH and all that stuff, but honestly, I'm actually disappointed with the booking right now.
And I see many people have that opinion too.
Yeah, and that, you know, I look at, like, a lot of the card for Ultimate Glory, and it's like, I just feel these matches at least could have been built up way better than they were, or they even are right now. Like, you know, like again, like your feud with Rap Metal, I mean, that should have went way better, except I think that one in the case is not really more of Travis's fault, but more of, like, I would actually say more of Rap Metal, where, you know, like, it's really, that's the one where the dedication comes into play, because I know, like, you know, like I said, like, you know, you put me in a feud or something. The same way we used to talk about, like, we'll try our best. We'll make it, make the best we can, put in the effort and all that. Rat Metal, I don't feel they're putting in the effort. I mean, I've only remembered, like, a few promos, and it's like, you know, like, very few promos, and this feud has been going on since, I think, like, October. No, not October, I think, like, the summer, actually.
This feud has been going on for a while. I don't remember exactly when it started, but I know it's been hinted at for a while, but it started to get rolling when we won the tag team titles, which was right after Ready to Rumble. And ever since then, we've been feuding. And, you know, I see me, Jay, and Carol, we're putting in work, we're putting in promos. And Rat Metal, they've had their a couple of promos, but it seems that they haven't had enough, and they're not interacting on the Facebook page. And I know anyone who follows you on Ask FM knows you've talked about that. You share the same view that me and other people have since we're going into Rat Metal.
Yeah.
And also, on top of that, do you think if Rat Metal wins the tag team titles at Ultimate Glory, do you feel they deserve them?
At this point right now, no, because, you know, like, the thing about when you're wanting to win a belt, like, Patriot, I thought he deserved the title because he was putting in the effort, he got all the hype. I thought this is, like, the perfect storybook ending to where, honestly, I think him and Alex should have been the main event for Ultimate Glory. I mean, that felt more like a Mania match. That whole thing, the ending, it was perfect. Rat Metal, the thing is, they're not putting in enough, which, it's surprising because they used to be doing a lot. I mean, before, like, the Rumble, they were doing, like, they were pretty active. They were doing promos and all that, but ever since this feud started, it feels like they're doing a lot less to where it's like, I'll be honest, these past few weeks, I forgot they were even on the roster. That's how bad it's been going. I mean, it gets to a point where if you put any other team in this position, I think they would have done better than Rat Metal. I mean, come on. You put the New Moon in there, do you think they would do better than Rat Metal?
Who's to say, but I feel New Movement would, since that's the team you used, and it's any of the tag teams, would have put in the work because they would have, you know, appreciated getting the shot. And I kind of have the look, and I think you agree, that Rat Metal kind of, they worked their ass off for months. They saw they were getting the opportunity to go after the tag team titles, and once they got that shot, they gave up.
Exactly. So it's like, you know, if they're not putting in the effort and stuff, it's like, why should you really be in rewarded? I mean, because think about it. Okay, you got hardworking guys at COH on the roster. You know, me, you know, like you said, New Movement are putting in effort, all this stuff. Yet, you know, Rat Metal's not doing much, and they're the one to get the belt before any of us.
Does
that make any sense to you?
It doesn't. I mean, who knows what's going to happen at Ultimate Glory? Or, you know, anything can happen. But if Rat Metal does win, I know, at least for me, and like you said, you agree with this, I can't say I support it because I don't feel they deserve it. Now, and that's another thing with the Bastards and Rat Metal. This is a feud that for months people wanted to see because we've been, you know, for a while, the two consistent tag teams that never really crossed paths. And now when you look at the tag team division, there are some teams that are starting to come out, whether it be now the Wolf Pack, whether it be New Movement, and we got Future Flight, and these new tag teams are starting to form. However, as it appeared to be that the tag team division was finally starting to, you know, get some life into it, that life might be gone come after Ultimate Glory, because COH is supposed to do a brand split. And I remember me and you talked about this before, how COH is going down the path of having two shows, and then each brand having tag team titles, and I don't see the possibility of having enough tag teams for that.
I agree, because some more thing about, you look at the vision now, it's like each brand, okay, let's see, you would have, here's basically the vision right now. You got you guys, you got Rat Metal, who still needs to put in more effort, and because of the lack of effort, I feel they're not as over as they used to be. And then you also got, you know, New Movement, and you got Future Flight. The rest are all the slam teams.
Mm-hmm.
Honestly, some of them I forget about because it's like, I feel maybe they need to do more effort too, but that's really my opinion on that. And basically, you know, you split that in half. It's like, you can't really have a division with that unless you're going to be like, you know, unless you're just, you're going to include teams like Ha Country, where despite, like, say, Nitro and the Internet title, they still form, and like, challenge the belts, but that's kind of it.
Yeah, unless there's new tag teams coming in, and that remains to be seen. Maybe Travis and is going to throw a curveball and have all these new tag teams come in, and I hope he does. But with what we got right now, it looks like having two tag team titles, there may not be enough on the roster. So there could be some trouble there for the tag team division. But there is one division that already has trouble, and that's just the mid-card division, and more specifically the pride title division.
Yes.
It's terrible. There's,
oh, my God. I'm telling you right now, Fisk right now, this, you know, he should have been the guy that he should have made this title into something, but because of the booking, that's not happening.
It's not happening. It's just, he's going to be looked at as another pride champion who sucks. Because look at the last pride champions. They have, they've all been considered bad champions. And for a while, it was the theme, oh, well, you're the pride champion, or, oh, it's just this person. It's Amir, it's Rockstone, it's Fisk, it's whoever. There hasn't been this good champion. But then it's so many people that are winning this belt and becoming irrelevant or not getting used right. Do you blame the person? Is it just the person? Or is it how that title is booked? Because it seems as the title is booked, it's big to win the belt, but the reign, there's not enough booking that goes into it. How many times has Fisk been either off of Battleground, or he's been just doing stuff for the Accurate Enterprise, not doing any work with feuding with someone like a TJ Profit, or his program with Great D right now, to where people even forget that Fisk's the champ?
Oh my God. I would say for this Pride title thing, it's a bit of both, because like with the past Pride champs, you could say it's like, you know, they should have been more dedicated, but at the same time, the booking also counts, because I think, like, say, Fisk's main problem as champion is the booking, because think about last Battleground, think about right before the CBB match, he's supposed to be this big monster heel, supposed to be a big challenge for Great D. Yet you're having him getting annihilated by Morse.
Oh, yeah, he was treated so badly in that match, and he's been treated so badly in this whole build. He's been treated badly ever since he won the title and ever since he's joined the Accurate Enterprise, because they keep the streak alive, and he was booked in matches against main event superstars, so he would have all these bullshit finishes or not be pinned, and it ended up hurting him to now this. He does not have the momentum he had back at Ready to Rumble. And so now I ask you this, with all the damage that has been done to Fisk as champion and Fisk as a character, whether he's champion or not, most people would agree the best thing for Fisk is to lose that title to the Great D at Ultimate Glory. How do you fix Fisk, or is Fisk just broken? Is there no way of coming back?
No, there's still hope for Fisk. Like, you could still fix him. I mean, because, you know, it's not like a Big Show or like a Kane where they're too late to fix. Fisk, you can fix him with, say, like a face turn, and then you still have to book him strong, because you cannot keep him looking this weak. Otherwise, you know, it's not going to work.
So
then, and as for losing the title to Great D, here's the problem, though. D has no build-up. He has no real build-up to getting this belt, and I think the only thing he's done as far as promo-wise was that interview on Battleground.
Right, and I agree with you. And I'll get to that in a second, because I do have a question with that. So you're saying maybe Fisk should keep the Pride title, try to still work something out, and would you say, and you offered the idea of maybe a face turn, or at least something to freshen him up and make him relevant again, because he desperately needs something.
Yes.
Okay. So now you brought up the Great D, and he hasn't had the work since the last Battleground. One thing with the Great D that has been a knock on him is that he was big in CCL, very big star in CCL, and he comes into COH, and it seems like out of nowhere is already got a Pride title match, getting pushed to the moon. I don't see a single person who is predicting that Fisk is walking out with that title. I think everyone thinks Great D's walking out with the belt, and I think Great D will walk out with the belt, and he's going to be champion, and he just debuted not too long ago. You got guys like Raging Redneck, who are coming in soon, and that he's already having promos and back and forth with the world champion. And, you know, and I'll let you speak in a second, but it's not that, I'm not saying that they're bad or anything. They're great, but they're getting their, some people will say they're getting pushed too soon. What are your take on that?
I can understand Great D, because like I said, he just came and, you know, like you said, the only one, like, interview and stuff. And, like, I've talked to Great D. He's a very nice guy.
Oh, yeah.
Very nice guy, and I like his voice and stuff for his promos. But, you know, I agree that, you know, it shouldn't be so soon. It should be, like, built up more. As for Ray Geddes, like, you know, even though people could say about, you know, okay, challenging the world champion right away, like, you shouldn't do that and stuff, I'd say at the very least, if you're going to have, like, you know, say Geddes versus Patriot, I say at least have Geddes go on, like, a path of destruction, like, you know, beating everybody, getting on the feud streak, and then, like, challenge Patriot for the title, because you can't do it right away, because, you know, you think about it, you cannot, what's the fun in the having, you know, Ray Geddes chase the belt, and that if he wins it right away, and why would you have Patriot beat him right away near his debut?
Alright, now, on the last episode of Battleground, we saw the big return of the Goonie. The Goonie is back after being gone since Anniversary, and has now suddenly decided to turn heel, where some people are in shock at the Goonie's return. Some people have some different opinions, which I know you do. So I'm going to give you the floor right now and tell me, what do you think about Goonie's return now and as a heel?
Honestly, my opinion, like, especially after talking to you and really and seeing, like, what AJ thought of it, I agree that This heel turn's just rushed. I mean, because like you said, like AJ said on Ask FM, where why are you doing this on the go home show to your WrestleMania? That is like if, say, in the John Cena vs. Rock, you decide to have Cena turn heel on the Raw right before the big match with the Rock. Like, you know, usually you would do that at the WrestleMania to create the big moment, but doing it right before, it just feels so random. It's like, think about it. First match, you know, right after the opener for Battleground, Goonie just comes running down with a pipe, attacking Morris that he didn't really have any history with. And then that's gonna set up the heel turn? Of a guy like Goonie, who really, when he does turn heel, it should be the Hogan, like, Hogan of Kaw from there. I mean, cause Goonie, it's like, he's basically the best babyface in Kaw. Or in COH, at least. So it's like, it should be that big moment that should be built up. And really, you know, I wouldn't say you should really turn him heel now. I mean, if there's anyone that should turn heel now, it really should be Zayn, because it's like, you know, I think he would need it for, you know, winning the title, you know, as situation, because, like, booking and everything. Mm-hmm. And really just, yeah, just really, and all this is set up to, like, a random triple threat for the Ultimate Glory pay-per-view. I mean, I know it's like, all I gotta say is, that just feels like TNA booking to me. And that's very harsh to say, but it's like, that's what it feels like, 2009 TNA.
Yeah, yeah, I certainly agree. Who knows what's gonna happen with the Goonie, and I know, I talked earlier to AJ Young, and he said something earlier, and he said on his stuff on his Ask FM, you can go check that out. The Goonie heel turn has been tried before, and it seems like this is just another example of a failed Goonie heel turn, because this has the potential to be a failure. Goonie may end up having to be face in a couple months because either the fans just won't be against him, or just because it was so rushed. It makes no sense at all. And do you feel the only reason why Goonie is back is because Travis fired Amir?
You know, now that I think about it a little bit, because I think the reason he didn't want to do, like, Neighbor's Mirror is, like, he didn't want that to be rushed. Yeah, here's the thing, though. You don't want that to be rushed, yet you do this. Like, you know, it doesn't make sense to me, and plus, it obviously had to be last minute, because, you know, if you're including Nate into this triple threat match, you know, obviously, like, you know, really, it should be a one-on-one match. Just be Nate versus Goonie, former tag team partners, former tag team champions. Like, why include Morris in the mix other than getting him on the card?
That's probably the only reason why. I see it as Travis had three guys he wanted to put on the card, and he just put them on there. And the go-home show was little to no story.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, although I will say, though, I think Gooney should win because, you know, he can't just turn heel right away and then lose. Because if he does lose, that would be dumb. But I have faith, I think he's going to win that match. Because that's honestly the right decision booking-wise. And like I said earlier, like, I think if anyone should be turning heel right now, it should be Zayn. Because think about it. The Zayn character, like I said, you know, it's been, would you say it was a, kind of been losing steam, you know, heading into Ultimate Glory?
Yeah, I would say he definitely has lost some steam. Ever since he won the Rumble, and I don't know if it's him not sending things in, but it seems his booking ever since has been lackluster, and it's not until recent episodes where he's been starting to being used to where people don't even see that match as the real main event.
Yeah, I mean, that's very bad, too. I mean, especially against a hot Patriot. Like, this is his prime right now. That's bad. And all you have to say, though, and I remember in, like, Gooney's heel promo, he mentioned, like, he thought Zayn didn't, like, deserve to be in the main event or something like that. And what I'm thinking is, okay, this should be totally reversed if they do have Gooney versus Zayn, because I'm sorry, even with heel Gooney right now, you do that feud right now, people are going to cheer Gooney. I'm going to cheer Gooney.
Yeah.
That's why Zayn should be heel, because when you think about how, you know, in all of his history in COH, how has the character really changed that much?
It has.
Because
it needs to change.
Yeah, exactly. And it's like, you know, he's teased the heel turn in the NATO versus Church feud, and he's even teasing it a bit with the Patriot thing, but if he never does that, if he never does the full-on heel turn, he's just going to look like a Cena.
Yeah.
Yeah, which is, like, it's very sad, because, like, it's bad I'm, like, saying all this, because it's, like, I talk to Zayn, too. He's a very nice guy as well, very talented, all this.
Oh, yeah,
but the booking is, but it's, like, in a way, the booking's kind of killing him.
The booking is killing him. And now, since we brought up Zayn and Patriot, let me ask you this. Two biggest matches on the card. Who's gonna win? First of all, who's gonna be walking out of Ultimate Glory with the World Championship? Is Patriot going to keep the belt, or is Zayn gonna finally win the title?
Okay, I'm thinking like two ways. It's like I'm gonna say an answer with my brain and one with my heart.
Okay.
And who I think should win and who I think will win.
All right.
Who I think should win is the Patriot, because when you think about it, he got the big moment at Honorversary winning the title. That big celebration, everything, hot in his prime right now, and he's going to lose the belt right away to Zayn, who's been losing steam. Like, that, especially in a face-versus-face kind of match, like, no, that doesn't seem right at all. And who I think will win, actually, I think Zayn will win. Like, I'm really hoping it's be a heel turn, because, I'm sorry, right now, Zayn as a face champion will not work. To me, at least. It will not work as a face champion. As a heel champion, it'll create interest because you've never seen Zayn as a heel.
Right.
That'll be the interesting thing. And when you think about it, if they do a rematch, that's going to be really interesting because, really, it's like the roles being reversed from their old feud, where it was Patriot as a heel, Zayn's face. Now it could be Zayn as a heel, Patriot as a face.
Yeah,
it's like, I'm thinking Zayn will win. I'm just hoping if he turning heel, do.
Okay. And then the other match, obviously, being M. Accuracy versus the Alex Enterprise. Loser leaves COH. Who's leaving?
Well, obviously, you know, we've known this rumor for many, really, at least me, I've known this rumor for many months that Alex is retiring, so he's going to be the one leaving.
Okay, you say Alex is leaving. So my follow-up question is, if Alex loses, do you think this is it for the Alex Enterprise? The Alex Enterprise is done in Call of Honor. There's nothing else he can do. Have we seen the last of him?
You know, I'd actually say yes in terms that, you know, when you think about it, he has done, like, everything. He's been here since near the start. He finally won the world title, and he's really a feud with a lot of the main guys. I mean, think about it, he's ending it now with him, actually, that people have been wanting for many, like, so many months, maybe even a year. And, you know, he's fought Gooney, he's fought Nate, he's fought all these guys. And it's like, you know, what else is there to do besides feud with Justin Bateman for the first time?
Right. Now,
or maybe even, like, you know, maybe, like, continue the feud with Caleb, but even then, it's like, what can you do next with that?
True. Now, with all that, with the stipulation and the title match, what goes on last? Because you know, you could look at it as the title match should always go on last because it's the most prestigious title on the show. But you could also look at it as, well, the Alex and Odds M Accuracy matches had better build up, and also one of them is leaving. So, and it's possibly their last match in COH. So, what goes on last?
Honestly, I would have to say Patriot versus Zane. I think I've answered this question before on my Ask FM, where obviously it's your world title match, but at the same time, it's like it's less predictable of the two because with that world title match, I have no fucking clue what they're gonna do. No clue whatsoever.
A lot of ways they can go.
Well, the Cruiserweight COH match, was it?
As I said, there's a lot of ways they can go.
Oh, I know. And then, at the same time, the Loser Leaves COH match, because of this rumor, I honestly, unless they, like, do a big swerve on me or, like, do something, I already think I know who's going to win that match entirely. And at the same time, think about it. What would you rather have as a main event? A big face-versus-face match or a big heel-versus-heel match?
True. All right. And the one thing I'm going to... One more thing I'm going to hit before we get to a series of name association, which should be very fun. There was a recent thing that happened on the COH Facebook page involving Scott. Scott took it upon himself to be, you know, he appeared to be out of character in his response to people like Kenyon Fenix and AJ Young. And he now, although he has claimed that that was just him being in character, it really struck people the wrong way. What is your take on Scott's recent drama, if you will, on the Facebook page?
I'll say about it, and I'll try to say it nice as, like, the nicest I can, because it's like, I would have to say, I think that was always the problem with Scott, is that I think, you know, you think there's, like, all a character with him, but at the same time, like, with some of these responses, it's like, they're not in character at all, because it's like, think about it. Why is AJ and IHOP being brought up if that has nothing to do with his character in COH whatsoever?
100% freaking agree.
Yeah, and then, you know, racism, like, remarks, too. It's like, you know, is that really needed? And then that's also, like, you know, it's one thing, you know, if he did this and you're allowed to do the same to him. But I've seen cases where if someone, like, were to do the same to him, he would, like, threaten to leave Ka and, like, just really get angry over it. So it's like, you know, it's just, you know, I can't. Yeah, that doesn't really go well at all. That's really the best way to describe that.
All right, Sonny, we're going to get to some fan questions submitted to my Ask FM, which people can send to askfm/SeanWalsh105 for future guests and on upcoming podcasts. So let's go to the first question here on Ask FM, that being, why did Adam, a.k.a. Kenyon Fenix, throw away Jay Crack's cookie?
He is a very despicable man. Very ungrateful. Just a hideous person. Like, I don't even want to talk about it that much. I mean, it was just, what a heel. That's all I got to say.
It's despicable. I know.
I agree.
You know what? Because of this, now I want Kevin to beat him at Ultimate Glory. All because of this, Adam. How dare you?
Go, Kevin. All right. Now we're going to
go, next. Kevin. Even though he should be booked a lot better than he is.
Yeah. All right, next question. Why do you flip-flop on your feelings about Daniel Mars?
It's really a weird thing where it's like, in the past, he has done a lot of stupid stuff. Like, you know, just a ton that I admit, yeah, they're very stupid, but at the same time, I am one guy to admit, at least his heel character right now, like, how he's going with it, I actually think is, I actually kind of like.
Okay. And we're going to do the last one of the Ask FM questions, and you don't have to go in full detail because we kind of addressed some of this earlier on. Can you elaborate on your past relationship with Atticus Marks, a.k.a. Kenyon Fenix, and how you felt about him then, and then how you feel about him now? I mean, you don't have to go into the story, but, like, how you feel about him from then and now.
Okay, well, as I said, like, me and him didn't really talk during the whole church thing, which is actually weird in itself, where it's like, you know, we didn't talk when we were together, but we talked when we fight each other. Like, that's usually a weird thing, but it's like, at the time I thought, you know, it was because he was actually, like, kind of cool and stuff, because, like, okay, it looks, like, his character was looking cool and stuff in, like, COH, but that was, like, that was really the extent of it. Mm-hmm. And then, like, after, you know, after I did get to know him, like, I saw, okay, this is a very nice guy and stuff, like, way different from the character and everything.
Yeah.
And much, really a much higher pitched voice, too. So I really thought his voice was going to be deeper.
Yeah.
I really.
Adam does have that, higher pitched voice.
So yeah, as far as, like, how you feel about him then, it's like, yeah, I liked him as, like, a character stuff. There was no, like, personal kind of thing. And, yeah, right. And as far as feeling him right now, he's a pretty good guy.
He likes to throw away cookies, but still a pretty good guy. All right. Now we're going to do the last segment of this podcast, and that being a simple name association. I'm pretty sure everyone else out there knows what name association is. Just give a couple – either a couple words or just like a sentence or just how you feel about this person, whether it be their character or them as people. Let's start things off with – The Alex Enterprise.
Very, you know, Alex is a very nice guy. Love his promos as, like, a heel and stuff, because he really gets intense, really into it. And I would say, like, I think he actually helped me where, like, you notice how, like, you know, I really started to do those, like, acting all angry and stuff in promos and all that. Like, I kind of got that from him and the whole short and sweet kind of deal.
Mm-hmm.
So he's definitely helped me get good advice and stuff. And so we're all great guys. So he deserved to get that COH title run that he did, and it's sad to see him go, really.
Yeah. All right. M Accuracy/The Patriot.
M Accuracy.
Steve.
All he has to say
otherwise.
Just, yes. Great. You know, no. The Patriot's a whole different guy, and
he's
really awesome.
So just some theory
remember,
I read
Steve's,
online.
Steve's the messenger. Patriot.
Right.
And all he has to say about Patriot though is very, just a very awesome guy. Like, he's honestly, like, right now, as far as the current roster, he's pretty much my favorite, like, character right now, favorite guy right now, and, yeah, he should keep that title.
Okay.
Should keep it. And as for M Action/Steve, all I'll say is that another very nice guy, giving me good advice and stuff, and just overall, like, I like his booking ideas and all that, where I think really, you know, depending on how Travis does with two brands, I think Steve should be a main booker for COH in general.
All right. And this one, since you went to it, you could make this one short and sweet. Adam/Kenyon Fenix, same person.
Well, as I answered that other question, you know, now, very good guy despite the cookie thing.
Okay. J-Crack.
Helped me a lot. Very funny. You know, very talented, very charismatic. All the good stuff. And, yeah, I'm just very glad to have met him in COG, because, you know, without him, I don't think I would even be doing good in COH at all right now.
Here's an interesting one. Good, buddy and rival at times. Ryan Carroll.
Badass. Just racist, stupid, just, you know, just fuck him.
Fuck him?
That's all there is to it.
All right. This one should be an interesting one, basically, because I know maybe a little bit more than some of the viewers might know about this one. Cash, otherwise known as COH, is Caleb Blair. What's your take on him?
Tranny.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
The Call All-Stars champion, AJ Young.
Very nice guy, also very funny, and, very, like, charismatic. Like, that's the thing about, you know, him and Jay share similar, is that very good talent to have and stuff, and AJ, you know, I like him both as a face and as a heel, and I'm just hoping he wins that COH title soon in the company.
I do agree. AJ is very charismatic. Would you say he's a charismatic angel, maybe charisma angel, if you will? Do you agree with that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right. Stefan Guerrero.
Let's see. Stefan, like, you know, I actually like him. You know, obviously, he's always one to, like, learn, you know, take in any advice and stuff. And, you know, I pretty much, I know some people, like, you know, like, I know, like, some people like Carol, they've had problems with the character stuff, but I don't really mind it. I think, like, you know, he's a good monster guy he can have as a heel and stuff. I think he would actually do pretty good as a face if he ever wanted to, and, yeah, just, I hope he gets more success in COH. I hope he, does good after the feud with Justin Bateman.
Speaking of Justin Bateman, that's the next guy, Justin Bateman.
Love him. All I gotta say, I mean, you know, he was definitely a guy that, you know, he really definitely helped me, just really helped me, you know, earlier on. I mean, like, the idea for, like, the angry promo stuff was, like, think of, you know, he told me this for advice. It's like, think of something that you really do not like, and then just, you know, think about it before you cut the promo, and then use that anger during the promo as you're, like, trying to do it. And that really helped. And the weirdest thing is that I remember the one time I got that upset win over him, he wanted to do it. That was his idea.
Oh, yeah.
So that meant a lot, and that meant a lot to me, because at the time, I think that was really when my push really started, actually, was that win, because before that, I was just, like, the follower guy, where it's, like, people were kind of taking notice, but not really, but then after that win, that's when everything really started to change during that whole thing. Really want to feud with him soon, COH.
That should be an interesting feud, show what happened down the line, and that's some great advice from Bateman. Maybe he used that advice for himself when he came and viciously attacked me and Ryan Carroll on that one episode of Battleground. I mean, I'm still waiting for the hospital bills, but one day he'll pay for it. One day. Scott Adams.
Okay, wait, before we continue on with Scott, I like to say that's another thing, too. I think Bateman should be booked more on Battlegrounds because I don't know why he isn't. Anyway, continuing with Scott, I think he also helped me earlier on, especially for, like, the commentary parts where he was willing to give me that criticism that I needed to improve and, like, really first learn about Audacity once I, like, met him. Mm-hmm. When I did my first, like, commentary of a match, which was, like, I think it was VCW Heat, where it was, like, my VCW character Wolfgang Sonny against the Goonie for the title after the whole Ultimate Glory 3 thing. And, yeah, early on, he really did help me a lot. Like, I know some people have some problems with him and all that stuff, and I can understand why and all that, but, you know, like, it's like kind of like a thing. Like, he'd definitely be a good one to have for if you really, like, need advice.
Okay. Rat Metal.
Levi's, like, he is, like, a nice guy and all that, and, Austin's another one, too, but they really need to do a lot more work in this whole feud with Ego before winning the titles, because I'm telling you right now, with how they're doing, literally anybody can do better than them in this feud, in this position, with how they're doing, because, you know what, you put me and the Sonic plush doll in that same position, and I think we would actually do a lot more than Rat Metal have done this whole, like, 8 months.
I dropped
and that doll, he would have about much to say as Levi does in this whole feud.
Monotone, my... Anyway. Ultimate Nitro.
Oh, very nice guy. You know, obviously, you know, like, he's obviously been around for a long while. I mean, he's finally getting his push now and stuff. Very happy for him for his success. And, yeah, like, you know, just a very good guy to, like, have on your roster and stuff. And, yeah, he's overall a very, very cool guy to talk to.
Okay. What about Marco Rose?
Oh, very nice guy. I like Marco. I mean, you know, he's been very good to me in YWF, and, you know, I always feel like I belong in there, and, like, obviously, like, you know, Marco, he's a very nice guy. Like, you know, he appreciates, like, the things you do for him in YWF, which I can definitely appreciate, and, you know, overall, I think as far as, like, direction goes, I think YWF actually right now has more direction than COH right now, as far as, like, on an overall level, as far as the storylines go. And, just overall, like, you know, very good guy and just very smart one, too, in book.
Now, since I mentioned Marco, you got to figure the next
one. Very charismatic, too. Huh? Wait, very charismatic, too.
Very charismatic. Yes. You got to figure the next guy I'm going to mention, since I mentioned Marco, being Chronix.
Oh, another nice guy, too. I mean, all I got to say, like, he is definitely, like, you know, like, most chill guy, like, ever. I mean, like, so more like, you know, like I said, very charismatic in his YWF thing, too. I mean, to a point where it's, like, he definitely deserves, like, the top heel spot that he's had for a while. And, yeah, you know, he listens to your ideas along with Marco. And, you know, just overall, like, you know, overall, they'll have, like, a direction for you and stuff. Like, they'll let you know, like, what's going on and everything. And it's, like, So overall, him and Marco are just a great pairing.
Okay. My Fisk and Bastard, Fisk.
Very nice guy. Very nice guy, although I think, as far as I've seen from his ass, like, I think he needs to be, like, a little more, like, you know how I've really been a lot, like, just really honest lately on my stuff on COH?
Right.
I think he kind of needs to show that, where, like, I see his thoughts on the Goonie turning heel, I'm like, you know, honestly, I don't know, like, I would have to wait until his response, but I think he really does not like the term, but he doesn't want to say it.
So you're thinking he's afraid to express his opinion because of what reaction he might get?
I think probably that, but also he probably doesn't want the risk of, like, angering, like, COH management, which I can understand because that's how I was at first. But it's like later on, but no, like, Travis, he will listen to you and everything.
Yeah, he will,
like, listen. Like, especially when you give ideas and stuff, which that's something I gotta tell all, like, new guys. Like, never be afraid to give ideas because Travis will listen to you.
Yeah. Here's an interesting one. Very controversial. Amir.
Actually, I think I have, like, a very good relationship with Amir.
He's a big fan of you.
Oh, yeah, and I'm also a big fan of him and, YWF and everything, too. Like, very good heel, you know, very talented, and, it's kind of a shame what has happened with him and COH, because, like, I think him and Nate could have had, like, a very good program together.
Yeah,
and just overall, I mean, overall, I think he really did have some potential in the company, but it's just unfortunate what happened, but hopefully, he's definitely going to do really well in the YWF with that internet side.
Yeah. You follow him on Twitter?
Yes.
Oh, okay. And then we're going to save the best for last. And no, it's not me. So we'll say second best for last. And that being the man behind COH, Travis.
Like I said, I mean, he gave me that chance at the start that I doubt anyone else would, and I really appreciate that, along with the push he's given me, because, like, right now, like, all I gotta say, if you would ask me, like, you know, when I started, if I would become what I am now, I would not have believed you. And overall, like, I would say, like, you know, he definitely has given me good advice, too, and, like I said, he really does listen to your ideas and everything, and, you know, it can go, like, all sorts of ways, you know, they can happen, they don't, like, he kind of does, like, give you a reason, like, you know, if he doesn't want to go with your idea. And, I would say overall, like, I think right now the booking's not so good, but all you have to say, I mean, 2013 COH was the best, honestly, the best time for Call for me, because, like, all that stuff that year, I mean, everything had a direction when it should, all the great talent, all that good stuff, I mean, and you really have to thank Travis for that, for making it happen.
Oh, yeah. All right. Well, that about wraps everything up. I'd like to thank you, Sonny, for being my first guest. It's been a hell of an interview. So thank you for coming on. That was one hell of a premiere. I'd really like to thank Sonny for coming on, being my first guest for the premiere of my podcast. There is plans to continue it, unlike other podcasts. So hopefully we'll be back here with another guest. Who might be the guest? Well, you'll find out soon. Keep looking on the Call Shoot page. I'll give that information in the coming weeks, where you will be able to submit questions, just like this interview. You'll be able to submit questions to upcoming guests. Who could be upcoming guests? It could be anyone. I'll give you a little hint, though. My upcoming guest could be anyone from my tag team partner, Ryan Carroll, my tag team partner, Jay Crack, Kenyon Fenix, AJ Young, anyone like that. There's a few guys that are in mind. Who's going to be the next one? You'll have to stay tuned for that. Thank you all for watching and giving this a listen. Hope you enjoyed what me and Sonny had to say, and I hope you agree, or at least were entertained by what we said. You don't have to like it, but as long as you're entertained, that's the point. I don't really give rat's ass if you like it or not. I just hope you're entertained. So thank you all for watching, and I hope to see you all on the next one. And as a special treat to all of you viewers for viewing the first edition of the Shawn Walsh Show, I'm going to give you guys a little extended preview. A little blooper reel. See how this all came about. It's quite funny. Again, thank you for watching. Alright, everybody. Now is the... Alright, here.
Really?
Okay, no, just keep recording. Keep recording. Keep recording. I can edit this out.
God. Oh, you put up a Robert and unedited.
Yeah.
The rest of that.
Save it for the blooper reel.
Yeah. I'll put it in the blooper reel. Alright. Alright, everybody.
Okay, this... Okay, it's black people.
Damn it, shut up.
This is St. George putting me black people.
Take three. Oh, okay, yeah. Now, let's talk about Sonny. Damn it, Sonny, you hung up. You disconnected again. We were almost done, too. I was only had a couple questions away from name association.
Should I stop recording?
Yeah, it'll take him like 20 minutes to get. Oh, yeah,
Zako, someone is calling my name. I'll answer that real quick.
Okay. I'll respond with my retort with when you make your turn. This will take 2 seconds, hopefully, so don't worry, people. Maybe he's going to do, like, maybe he has to do, like, a prayer. Don't they have to do, like, 5 prayers a day or something?
I heard that, and...
Why did Adam, a.k.a. Kenyon Fenix, throw away Jay Crack's cookie? It's a question we all want to know. Do you have the answer? Sonny?
This is very important, Sonny. I need to know why Adam did this.
He doesn't know the answer.
He's currently shocked right now. No, his computer, his Wi-Fi was so shut that what Adam did, that he just stopped. He goes, he can't. My nigga.
My nigga. Yeah. That's literally what it is. It's not even, like, comprehensible.
Lester.
Let it begin. There's no beginning.
What the? Oh, come on. Why the fuck you get sag? Why are you singing Coming Undone?
I don't know.
Okay, you can end your recording right there.